IAS 36 deals with impairment of non-current assets. So specifically, IAS 36 is applicable on land, building, machinery and equipment that is tangible non-current assets covered under IAS 16, investment property which is carried at cost, intangible asset under IAS 38, goodwill, and assets carried at revalued amount under IAS 16 and 38. Similarly, investment in subsidiaries, associates, and joint ventures that are carried at cost. Now, the key definition under IAS 36. First of all, what is impairment loss? So we know that if the carrying amount of an asset is greater than its recoverable amount, then the asset is said to be impaired. So the amount by which the carrying amount of an asset or cash generating unit exceed its recoverable amount. So for example, if carrying amount of an asset is 500 and its recoverable amount is only 400, then the excess 100 is impairment loss. So in order to calculate impairment, you have to identify carrying amount and its recoverable amount. So what is carrying amount? Carrying amount is the amount at which an asset is recognized in the balance sheet, that is the book value. So after deducting accumulated depreciation and accumulated impairment loss. So from the original cost, deduct the accumulated depreciation or accumulated amortization and accumulated impairment loss in order to find out the book value or the carrying amount. As far as recoverable amount is concerned, the recoverable amount is the higher of the asset's fair value less cost of disposal, sometimes known as selling cost price, net selling price, and its value in use. So we can say that in order to find out the recoverable amount is the higher of VIU, value in use, and fair value less disposal cost. So calculate these two values and take the higher of in order to get the recoverable amount. Then compare this recoverable amount with the carrying amount. If carrying amount is greater than recoverable amount, the asset is said to be impaired. Otherwise, there will be no impairment loss. Now, fair value less cost of disposal. How you can find out fair value of an asset? So for fair value identification, we usually refer to IFRS 13 fair value measurement. And under IFRS 13, the fair value is the price that would be received to sell an asset or paid to transfer a liability in an orderly transaction between market participants at the measurement date. So fair value is simply, in case of asset, the price that we will receive by selling an asset. As far as value in use is concerned, it is the present value of future cash flows expected to be derived from an asset or cash generating unit. For example, if you have an asset and its remaining life is 5 years, so identify future cash flows and then discount these cash flows in order to find out the present value. Now, how can we identify that whether an asset is impaired or not? So in order to find out the impairment, or in order to check that whether impairment testing is needed or not, so at the end of each reporting date, an entity is required to assess where there is any indication. We have to identify indicators that an asset may be impaired. So IAS 36 has a list of external and internal indicators of impairment. Once you know that there is an indication that an asset may be impaired, then the asset's recoverable amount must be calculated. So at each year end, identify indicators. If there is no indicator, there is no need to calculate recoverable amount. But if there is an indicator, then do calculate recoverable amount, that is value in use, fair value less cost to disposal, and take the higher value. The recoverable amount of following types of intangible assets are measured annually, whether or not there is any indication that it may be impaired. This is the compulsory annual impairment testing of these assets, which are intangible asset. And such assets are an intangible asset having an indefinite useful life, an intangible asset not yet available for use, and goodwill acquired in a business combination. So we can see that These are compulsory impairment testing at each reporting date. We have to calculate recoverable amount at annually. Now, as far as indicators are concerned, there are two types of indicators: external source of indicators and internal source. In external source, if the asset's market value declines, this is an indicator of impairment, and we have to calculate recoverable amount. If there are any negative changes in terms of technology, change in technology, in terms of markets, in terms of the economic situation, in terms of laws. So if you are using assets and there are negative changes in either technology, markets, economy, or laws, then recoverable amount is needed to be calculated. And if there is any increase in market interest rate, if market interest rate increases, that will reduce the present value of an asset and value in use decreases. And if net assets of the company is higher than its market capitalization, that is the number of shares multiplied by share price, that is the market value. If net assets are greater than the market capitalization, that it's an indicator of impairment. As far as internal source are concerned, so physical damage or obsolescence, an asset is part of restructuring, or an asset held for sale, IFRS 5, and the performance of the asset is worse than expected. For example, a machine is being used and it's not performing well. An aircraft is being used and it's not performing well, having some problem, that is an indicator of impairment. If there is an indicator of impairment, then it also indicates that asset's useful life, depreciation method, residual value may need to be reviewed and adjusted. It means we have to reassess all these variables and check that whether life is the same or not, and we have to either change the life or scrap value or something else. Now, as far as the determination of recoverable amount is concerned, we have already discussed that it is higher of. So if fair value less cost of disposal or value in use is more than carrying amount, it is not necessary to calculate the other amount the asset is not impaired. If fair value less cost of disposal cannot be determined, then recoverable amount is only value in use. And for asset to be disposed of, such as in the case of IFRS 5, recoverable amount is only fair value less cost of disposal. So sometimes the recoverable amount is either fair value less cost of disposal or its value in use. In order to calculate fair value less cost of disposal, fair value is measured in accordance with IFRS 13, and disposal cost are the direct added cost only, not existing cost and overhead. For value in use, we have to calculate the estimate of the future cash flows that an entity expect to derive from the asset, expectation about possible variation in the amount or timing of those cash flows, changes in cash flows, and then considering the time value of money and other factors such as the price for bearing the uncertainty in the assets, other factors as well. So the future cash flows, consider the future cash flows and discount using the suitable discount rate and find out the PV. This is called the value in use of an asset. Now, if an asset is impaired, then impairment loss, what is the accounting treatment of impairment loss? So in case of impairment of asset, the accounting treatment is that an impairment loss is to be charged in profit and loss account. But sometimes, if the asset is revalued and is already revalued, then an impairment loss is to be charged against revaluation surplus. In that case, the impairment is to be adjusted in OCI. So sometimes impairment is to be charged directly in profit and loss account, and sometimes impairment to be adjusted against the available revaluation surplus until that surplus is being eliminated. Then excess amount is to be charged in profit and loss account.